Well, good morning. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer as we begin. Father in heaven, we just pause to say thank you for the gift of life, the gift of another day. And as we open your word to study about living water, we pray that the Holy Spirit will be present, guide our thoughts and our minds. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Well, I've always been fascinated by the term living water. And one of the places in the New Testament where Jesus refers to living water is found in John chapter 7. And if you open your Bibles there, you will see that his family was preparing to go to the Feast of Tabernacles. The verses I'll be referring to are in John 7, verses 37 and 38. I had the privilege in 2006 of standing on the steps where they believed that Jesus shared these words with the crowd. As you work your way through the chapter, you'll probably notice that his family was preparing to go to the Feast of Tabernacles, but when they asked Jesus to accompany them, they said, "Aren't you coming?" And he replied, "No, my time is not yet." But as you read through the chapter, you'll recognize that although he was not with the family initially, there was a lot of talk about Jesus of Nazareth in the city of Jerusalem. Jesus did arrive later on. More discussion took place. But let's refer to those two verses. In John 7, it reads like this. On the great day of the feast, the last day of that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, "If any man thirst, let him come to me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water." When Jesus spoke in John 7 about the living water, many commentators believe that he was referring to Isaiah 55, the first couple of verses. And actually, it recalls to my mind one of my favorite scripture verses or scripture songs. And I don't know if any of you remember this song, but it goes something like this, using the King James Version. "Oh, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. He that hath no money, come ye buy and eat. Wherefore," verse 2, "wherefore do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not?" Hallelujah. "Oh, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. He that hath no money, come ye buy and eat." That's Isaiah 55, verse 1 and verse 2. What does living water mean to you? Do you have living water? Well, let's add a verse, and I think it will help answer our question. Verse 39 reads, "But this he spake of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified." Notice that it says those that believe on Jesus have this living water. And if we allow it, that is, living water is the Holy Spirit's living in us, speaking through us, we can share the good news of living water with others. Recently, a number of us have been following a series called Story Encounters, where Ty Gibson and David Asherick walk us through the series known as The Chosen. The very last episode was the one of the woman at the well. And that's the next place that we find in Scripture that Jesus referred to this living water. Let's go to that verse right now. That's in John chapter 4. As we talked about this series and working our way through the discussions by Ty and Dave, some of our group mentioned, this is too good not to share with others. And so, Bernadine, we're getting to share today. Let's go to the story now as shown on The Chosen.
Give me a drink. Did you hear me?
That's bad, huh?
What?
You, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a Samaritan, and a woman.
I'm sorry. I should have said please.
You know, it's not safe for you to be alone out here.
Nor you. Why haven't you come with others? Why so late in the day? Don't women come to the wells in the cool of the morning?
Yeah, well, none of them will be seen with me, so I have to come out new in the heat, as you have so kindly reminded me.
Why won't they be seen with you?
Long story.
I'd still like a drink of water if you can spare it.
Amazing what a parched throat will do. Aren't I unclean to you? Won't you be defiled by this vessel?
Maybe some of my people say that about your women, but I don't.
Yeah? And what do you say?
I say if you knew who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink.
Really?
And I would give you living water.
Would. Except that you have nothing to draw water with, and this is a deep well. Besides, what do you need from me if you have your own supply of living water?
Long story.
But Jewish water is better than Samaritan water, hmm?
That's not what I said.
Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well? Your water is better than his?
I know Jacob. And everyone who drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks the water that I give him will never be thirsty again.
Wouldn't that be nice?
The water I give will become in a person a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
Really?
Yes, really.
Prove it.
First, go and call your husband and come back. I will show you both.
I don't have a husband.
You are right. You've had five husbands. And the man you're living with now is not your husband.
Oh, I see. You're a prophet. You're here to preach at me.
No.
Usually the one good thing about coming here alone is I can escape being condemned.
I'm not here to condemn you.
I've made mistakes. Too many. But it's men like you who have made it impossible for me to do anything about it.
How?
Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain. But you Jews insist Jerusalem is the only place for true worship.
They say that because the temple is there.
Yeah, exactly where we're not allowed.
I'm here to break those barriers. And the time is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father.
So, where am I supposed to go when I need God? I've never received anything from God, but I couldn't thank him even if I did.
Anywhere. God is spirit, and the time is coming and is now here that it won't matter where you worship, but only that you do it in spirit and truth. Heart and mind, that is the kind of worshiper he's looking for. It won't matter where you're from or what you've done. Do you believe what I'm telling you?
Until the Messiah comes and explains everything and sorts this mess out, including me, I don't trust in anyone.
You're wrong when you say that you've never received anything from God. This Messiah you speak of, I am he. The first one was named Ramin. You were a woman of purity, was excited to be married. But he wasn't a good man. He hurt you. And it made you question marriage and even the practice of your faith.
Stop it.
The second was Farzad. On your wedding night, his skin smelled like oranges. And to this day, every time you pass by the oranges in the market, you feel guilty for leaving him. Because he was the only truly godly man you've been with, but you felt unworthy.
Why are you doing this?
I have not revealed myself to the public as the Messiah. You are the first. It would be good if you believed me.
You picked the wrong person.
I came to Samaria just to meet you. Do you think it's an accident that I'm here in the middle of the day?
I am rejected by others.
I know. But not by the Messiah.
And you know these things because you are the Christ. I'm going to tell everyone.
I was counting on it.
Spirit and truth.
Spirit and truth.
It won't be all about mountains or temples.
Soon, just the heart.
You promise?
I promise.
This man told me everything I've done. Oh, he must be the Christ!
Hey, wait!
Your water!
You forgot your
Papsy, you man! You told me everything I ever did!
Rabbi, we got food. What would you like?
I have food to eat that you do not know about. Who got you food?
Wait a minute. You told her? Mm-hmm. And she can tell others?
What food? My food is to do the will of him who sent me. And to accomplish his work.
You told her who you are?
Mm-hmm.
So does that mean?
It means we're going to stay here a couple of days. It's been a long time of sowing. But the fields are ripe for harvest.
And so it's time.
We need to adjust our course 30 degrees.
We're not going to the Jordan. We're going through Samaria.
Are you telling a joke?
There's a place there I want to stop. Plus, it makes our journey shorter by almost half.
And our odds of violent attack more likely by double.
Is that an exact figure?
Forgive me, teacher, but it's safer to go around Samaria by way of the Jordan than the Decapolis.
Would you join me for safety reasons?
But Rebbe, you're Samaritans.
Good observation, Big James. What's your point?
Rabbi, these were the people that profaned our temple with the dead bones. They hated
they
us.
Fought they fought against us with the Seleucids in the Maccabean Wars. They've never even spoken to a Samaritan.
And we destroyed their temple 100 years ago.
Hmm.
And none of you here were present for any of these things.
Come on now.
This is pretty phenomenal.
What Jesus does there is amazing. He basically says, yeah, they've done wrong to our people,
but we've done wrong to them. Yeah, yeah. We're not fundamentally better than them. They're not fundamentally better than us.
There are no innocent figures in history, in terms of historical figures, historical nations, empires.
Right.
There's not, I know we often think good guys, bad guys, and there is, you know, definitely worse cultures and worse empires and better cultures, but nobody gets off scot-free.
No.
Nobody gets off scot-free. The record of history is what it is. And so Jesus is like, yeah, they did that to us, and we did this to them.
Yeah. This is a theme that shows up a few times. This reminds me of when Peter is just completely blown away that Jesus is calling Matthew. Right? And he says he's a tax collector, so this is different, right?
Yeah.
And Jesus says, what does he say to him?
Get used to different.
Yeah. You were surprised when I called you. Why are you surprised when I'm calling him?
Correct.
Okay, so literally from a biblical standpoint, again, getting into the biblical theology behind this thinking, right? You and I have never witnessed anybody do anything that was so bad that you and I wouldn't do the same thing, given the same pressures and circumstances and genetics and upbringing.
Right.
All of us, according to Scripture, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, not one,
come on now,
according to Scripture. And these guys are not different than these guys.
Correct.
So we're as much inclined to stratify the world and society. Some are good, some are bad, some are better than others. And Jesus just says, what's your point?
Yeah.
I love those words. What's your point, James?
Yeah, astute observation. He does say that, doesn't he?
Astute observation. They're Samaritans.
What's
you know
your
that,
point?
I know that, I still want to go there.
Yeah.
You're not bringing any new knowledge to the table. I know they're Samaritans. I know they've done wrong, but I know we've done wrong to them as well.
I got to tell you, I just had the most amazing encounter, and I'll tell this story very quickly. I was just in Wyoming recently with my good friend of ours, Pastor Nathan Renner, and we went to this hot springs in a little town there in southern Wyoming, and it's a place called Thermopolis, and there's these travertine hot springs that spring up from the ground, and you can go there. There's a public bathhouse. It's free. We go there on our off days for climbing because it's hot water. It feels good.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Nathan and I went into the bathroom there, and I just remarked to Nathan, because we had just been fishing and we didn't have our shampoo and soap with us, I said, man, I wish I had some soap and shampoo. And then there's a gentleman in the stall that says, I have some. He just overheard me saying this, and he comes out, and he's this great, big, tall, enormous, tattooed Native American. And where I come from in South Dakota, I was born in Wyoming, raised in South Dakota, there's a lot of Native Americans there. And he's this great, big, intimidating looking figure. But he's overheard a couple guys that he doesn't know say, oh, I've got some soap and shampoo. And he gives us the soap and he gives us the shampoo. We end up having a conversation that lasted more than a half an hour. And we're just asking him about his reservation, where he's from, his ancestry. And he's just speaking with great enthusiasm. Now, this is Kitai. We're having a really great conversation back and forth, and he's asking us and we're asking him. And at one point, we're talking about the history of America and the history of his people in particular. And he says, Ty, this was amazing. He says, well, when you guys came over, you did it. And then he stops himself and he goes, well, not you guys, but the people that were before you.
Nice.
And in that moment, he was having a realization. He was recognizing what's happening here.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. If you go back far enough in history, your people have been bad to my people, and my people have been bad to your people.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But how are we going to treat one another right now, right here today? And that's what Jesus is saying.
Jesus is doing something even more groundbreaking and revolutionary in the sense that he's flattening out this whole division between peoples. And he's
saying
this whole idea of my people, your people.
It's us.
It's us. There is no us and them. There's just us. That's all there is.
Amen. It was so cool to me when we were having this. His name was Tom. Actually, Tom Elk. And just when he said that, and he caught himself because we were having this positive interaction, and he's like, not you guys.
That was very perceptive on his part, wasn't it?
Well, it was just so brilliant. And I thought to myself, there's not you and me. That's the thing that Jesus came to show. And that's what we're already seeing here in The Chosen is, it's not tax collectors and fishermen and the Roman. No, it's not them and us.
It's us. It's us, yeah.
It's us. Beautiful.
So then we come to the woman at the well, the encounter. Jesus.
They all go into town
Jesus
to buy some food.
Jesus deliberately positions himself
yes.
at the well. He's just waiting there, right?
Yeah.
He knows she's coming somehow, and he is there when she arrives, and the tension in the air...
It's thick
because these are Samaritans, and when Jesus says, I'd like a drink of water, would you get me a drink of water? She just doesn't know what to think because she's assuming what's going to happen is that here's a Jewish man, she's a Samaritan woman, what's going to happen?
Here comes the argument, here comes the condemnation.
He's going to sit there in judgment and condemnation on her. Either ignore her or condemn her. Those are the two options.
Right.
She can't even conceive of the possibility of a third option, that a Jewish male would somehow receive a gift of water from the hands. And the vessel, she says, isn't this vessel
going to be
unclean for you? Won't you be defiled? And
yeah,
she has a little attitude.
No,
right? And you can't
I'm so glad you said that.
Attitude. She's been through a lot, and she cannot help but expect either to be ignored or to be condemned. And Jesus just gradually, skillfully begins to open a conversation.
Yes, thank
David,
you.
David, I'd like to suggest that the gospel is the highest form of healing psychology.
Whoa, come on.
Now, in our culture now, we talk about, you know, counselors and psychiatrists and psychologists and therapists, and you go with someone and you deliberately sit with them to have an interaction in order to open up whatever traumas and dysfunctions and wounds that are inside of you, right? It's an appointment you make and you go. This is Jesus doing it real time, just as an interaction with a woman. He is the great physician, not only of physical ailments.
Come on.
He is the great physician of psychological, emotional, relational trauma and dysfunction. Mm. And here's this woman. She's been through some stuff. She's got miles on her soul.
She's got
miles on her soul, and they are hard miles. She's haggard. She's worn. She's tired. She's coming to the well.
She's jaded.
She's coming at a time of the day to avoid contact with all the other women because they don't want to be seen with her. They don't want to be around her. And Jesus, I guess my point is that these scenes show us Jesus gradually opening up her heart.
Yes.
She responds with barbs, but he doesn't respond to the barbs. He just keeps moving forward. Well, what about, and how about, and gradually you watch her soften.
Yeah.
You watch her soften because Jesus is kind of cradling her wounded heart in his hands.
Beautiful.
And gently handling her, knowing that she is wounded. And as she begins to open up, it dawns on her, wait a minute, I'm not sensing condemnation here. I'm not sensing anything incriminating.
Yeah.
And that's all she's ever really known.
She has a snarkiness to her. She has a...
Which you would expect.
She has an irritation to her. I mean, this scene plays out very much like I imagine it in my mind's eye, where she rebuffs Jesus repeatedly, but Jesus, with a calm, patient, winning persistence...
Right.
Softens her and opens her up. So this was a long dialogue. We're going to look at two clips. So let's look at the first of those clips and just really pay attention to the way that Jesus disarms her obvious hostility.
I'd still like a drink of water if you can spare it.
Amazing what a parched throat will do. Aren't I unclean to you? Won't you be defiled by this vessel?
Maybe some of my people say that about your women, but I don't.
Yeah? And what do you say?
I say if you knew who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink.
This is incredible.
Really?
And I would give you living water.
Would. Except that you have nothing to draw water with, and this is a deep well. Besides, what do you need from me if you have your own supply of living water?
Long story.
But Jewish water is better than Samaritan water.
That's not what I said.
Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well?
I knew Jacob.
Your water is better than his?
I know Jacob.
I know Jacob.
And everyone who drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks the water that I give him will never be thirsty again.
This is so good. Watch this.
Wouldn't that be nice?
The water I give will become in a person
a spring
of water welling up to eternal life.
Really?
Yes, really.
She's still hard.
Prove it.
First, Go and call your husband
He's
and
about
come
to
back.
Prove it.
I will show you both.
I don't have a husband.
You are right.
You've had five
husbands.
Okay, there we go. There's
and
a little
softening.
The man
you're living with now is not your husband.
What? What?
Oh, I see.
This nervous laugh.
That was
you're
great.
You're a prophet. You're here
you're
to preach at me.
So now she's thinking,
you should
okay.
have one
yeah,
good
here
thing
about
coming here alone, is I can escape being condemned.
I'm not here to condemn you.
I've made mistakes. Too many. But it's men like you who have made it impossible for
see,
me to do anything about it.
How?
Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain. But you Jews insist Jerusalem is the only place for true worship.
They say that because the temple is there.
Exactly where we're not allowed.
I'm here to break those barriers.
I came to break those barriers.
And the time is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father.
So,
confusion.
Where am I supposed to go when
what?
I need God?
What?
I've never received anything from God, but I couldn't thank him even if I did.
Anywhere. God is spirit.
Here we go. I love
and the
this.
The time is coming and is now here. That it won't matter where you worship, but only that you do it.
Yes.
In spirit
and in truth.
And truth. Heart and mind. That is the kind of worshiper he's looking for. It won't matter where you're from or what you've done.
Look at her processing. She's processing. I've never heard anything like this in my whole life. All I am familiar with is this mountain or this mountain.
Right.
This place, geographic
religious
location
argumentation
of worship. This geographic location of worship. Everybody's arguing. Where's the place? And Jesus says, No. God is a spirit, and he's looking for those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. It's
Hallelujah.
Heart and mind. It's just, this is groundbreaking revelation.
Yeah. Yeah,
she's never heard anything like this in her
life.
She's
having the same experience that Nicodemus had when Jesus says something, he doesn't know where to put it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because in that world, in that context, people, there were just only so many items on the menu. There were only so many offerings at the buffet, and people knew where to put each of those.
Right.
Well, Jesus shows up. He doesn't sound like a Pharisee. He doesn't sound like a traditional Jew. He doesn't sound like a Sadducee. He doesn't sound like a zealot or an Essene.
Mm-hmm.
Who is this guy? You see it with Nicodemus and his interaction there. You see it with Matthew. And now you see it with the woman at the well. She's processing. That's exactly the right word. What?
Yeah, the key line here, David, I think, is I'm here to break those barriers.
Yeah.
Did you catch that?
Of course.
I'm here to break those barriers. What barriers? The barriers that people create to divide people. And these are...
Back to the us and them.
Yeah, us and them. This is a context in which those barriers are religious in nature. Imagine this.
They're religious, they're linguistic, they're geographical.
Yeah. The very thing that was meant to bring people together is being used to drive people apart.
Yep.
Right? I came to break down those barriers, Jesus says. And this is a powerful insight that is developed by all of the biblical writers, all the New Testament writers after this, but especially Paul, you know, where he sees in Jesus that the walls of hostility and enmity are going to be brought down between people.
Yes.
The vertical relationship with God is healed for the purpose of healing our vertical relationships.
Horizontal
relationships. I mean, John is so explicit on this that he says in 1 John, that if you say you love God, that's the vertical, right? But you don't love your brother, you're lying. There is no authenticity to your religious claim of vertical relationship with God. You sing songs of praise, you give money to the church, you go to the right building on the right day, you sit in the pew, you go through the motions of religiosity, right? But if you hate your fellow human beings in your heart, Jesus is essentially telling her, well, it's all a big charade. It's not real. Mm. And God is looking, I mean, I'm just going to translate when he says to her, God is a spirit and he's looking for those who worship in spirit and truth. Essentially saying he's looking for authentic worshipers whose worship of God pans out in the way they treat people.
Not just
and
vertically,
Jesus
but
is
horizontally.
Modeling that. He's treating her the way God would treat her in the circumstance
Beautiful.
as a modeling of the way we're to treat one another.
all of that is beautifully said, Ty, and so true that the you could say it this way, the horizontal is a barometer of the vertical.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We can gauge the temperature of this
right.
by looking at this.
Yeah, the moment I look up to God, he points me to people.
Correct. Well, and Jesus says this, doesn't he, in Matthew chapter 25? He says, whatever you've done to the least of these, I was naked, you gave me clothes. But Master, when did we do that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, well, when you did it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters,
That's
you
right.
did that to me.
Yeah.
Okay, so the woman is slowly softening. It's mm-hmm. dawning on her that Jesus is different. And there's that great scene there where he starts telling her the names of her first husband and then her second husband. I mean, that scene is powerful. And then as that scene kind of draws to its close, she has the realization. She's transitioned from hardness and,
She's not just softened. She's over the moon with joy.
She's enthusiastic.
Yeah.
And so let's look at that scene.
I have not revealed myself to the public as the Messiah. You are the first. It would be good if you believed me.
I love that so much.
That's great. Here they come.
You picked the wrong person.
Aww. I came to Samaria just to meet you. Do you think it's an accident that I'm here in the middle of the day?
I am rejected by others.
I know.
But not by the Messiah.
But not by the Messiah.
Woo! Come on. There it is. That's where the penny drops.
Things.
The realization right there.
You are the Christ.
You're the Christ.
He affirms.
Yeah.
That's the title here. I am He.
I'm going to tell everyone.
I'm going to tell everyone.
I was counting on it. That's so good.
Spirit and truth.
Spirit and truth.
It won't be all about mountains or temples.
Ooh. Soon.
I love this. Promise?
Just the heart.
Promise?
You promise.
I promise.
Beautiful.
This
I love this scene here.
Told me everything
of them passing one another.
Oh, he must be the Christ!
They're like, lady, you forgot your pot.
Hey, wait!
The only one that smiles is Mary.
Oh, yeah, Mary gets it. She knows this story. This is her story. That's a great observation.
Yeah.
Mary's smiling because Mary sees in this woman, this is my, I know this story.
Mary sees the woman, all the dudes see the water pots.
Great point.
That she loved. Hey, by the way, since we mentioned Mary, I just want to throw out there, some people may wonder, I've actually had people ask this question before, what in the world? A woman traveling with the disciples,
right.
That didn't happen, did it?
Right.
According to Luke chapter 8, the first few verses, Luke chapter 8, everybody, take a look at the first few verses.
It wasn't just Mary, it says there were women.
Yeah, there were other women, and they were traveling with Jesus and the disciples. They were a part of this heavenly posse,
beautiful.
If you will, that are going to do damage to the kingdom of darkness.
You.
So
well, we hope that you have enjoyed the Story Encounters series. We have thoroughly enjoyed doing this. It has been, it's been highlight after highlight after highlight after highlight.
It sure has,
And I'm in expectation of what season 2 and 3 and everything beyond holds. Because if it's been this good in season 1, it can only get better in seasons 2, 3 and beyond.
Yeah.
And so a big shout out to Dallas Jenkins and his team and the studio there, Angel Studios, for doing this. And a big shout out to the Hope Channel for inviting us to come on and have this conversation.
And to you for joining us on this exciting journey. Thank you so much. And hopefully the conversation is not yet done.
I think the verses starting with John 4:39 are a wonderful way to wrap up our time together today. Many Samaritans from the village believed in Jesus because the woman had said, "He told me everything I ever did." When they came out to see him, they begged him to stay in their village, so he stayed for 2 days, long enough for many more to hear his message and believe. Then they said to the woman, "Now we believe, not just because of what you told us, but because we have heard him ourselves. Now we know that he is indeed the Savior of the world." Well, how do we apply this to our role here at Riverside? You'll notice as the woman left, the disciples were saying, "Did you get something to eat? Would you like something to eat? Where did you get food to eat?" And Jesus said, "I have food that you don't know about." And as they pressed him, he said, "You know the saying, 4 months between planting and harvest? But I say, wake up and look around. The fields are already ripe for harvest. The harvesters are paid good wages. The fruit they harvest is people brought to eternal life. What joy awaits both the planter and the harvester alike. You know the saying, one plants and another harvests, and it's true. I sent you to harvest where you didn't plant. Others had already done the work, and now you'll get to gather the harvest." Jesus pointed out that the fields are ripe for harvest, and I think we've seen that here at Riverside. We have visitors and guests new almost every Sabbath. What do they experience when they come here to Riverside? Do they experience the living water that you share because of your love and your care for them? I believe the time is ripe and ready for the harvest. And wouldn't it be wonderful if some of our guests and visitors, newcomers, new friends would say, "You know, when I first came to Riverside, I wasn't really sure there was a God. But after listening to Pastor Merrill or talking with you, I decided there must be a God because of the answers to prayer you shared and what I heard from Pastor Merrill." But wouldn't it be even more wonderful if they reach a point where they say, "Now I believe not only that there is a God, but I believe because I've heard him myself. I have started my own devotionals, my own Bible reading, and I've met Jesus in person. And I just want to thank you for sharing your living water with me." Wouldn't that be wonderful? As we close, we'll sing together a story that reflects on the woman at the well called "Fill My Cup, Lord." Join us as we sing together, "Like the Woman at the Well." Thank you, Father, for meeting with us today, reminding us that the living water is the Holy Spirit living within us, sharing your love with us. And then because of the good news, we can't keep it to ourselves. We're willing to share it with others. Lord, bless each one of us in the hearing of your words today. May we do what we can to share living water with others. You've told us the harvest is ripe and ready. Give us the strength, the courage to share this good news with others and reap the harvest, which will bring great joy in heaven. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a wonderful Sabbath.